Consumer products sold under the Teflon brand are safe. DuPont did, in fact, ask EPA to make those statements, correct?
That's correct.
When I was pregnant with Bucky, I worked for DuPont around Teflon. They tried to blame me. They said it was something that I did. The more they would tell me that, the more suspicious I got.
You did see there was a substantial risk to the women at the DuPont plant.
There was no potential risk to the women. There was a potential risk to the fetus.
It was used in consumer products, manufacturing products, and the applications were endless. These Teflon and Scotchgard chemicals permeated the living world. Today, every baby is born with Teflon chemicals in their blood.
DuPont and another company called 3M had been studying this chemical dating back to the 1950s and 1960s.
Did you work with a lot of other people that have been sick or died early?
Carol Kaplan, Jim Broadwater, Joy Weaver, Steve Bailey, Lona Carr.
They are aware of the risk of the product.
Risk is relative.
If I go out here and sprinkle arsenic around, they'd arrest me for murder.
You've lied, and they're still lying.
Everybody in this area, in one way or another, is connected to DuPont. You go dealing with somebody's livelihood, you're gonna have problems.
There was a discussion about, do we need to come up with something in our production that's not gonna cause these problems? They conclude, if we launch something new, it's gonna cost us a lot of money. We have to stick with the devil we know.
Was I a guinea pig? What do you think?
For nearly 70 years, chemical companies like 3M and DuPont have known that PFOA and PFAS chemicals, commonly known as C8, could build up in our blood. They've also known that these same chemicals have a deadly toxic effect on our organs, but they hid those facts from the public. This new insider-exclusive Justice in America Network TV special exposes their decades of deception and death. DuPont was a manufacturer of the plastic material Teflon in Parkersburg, West Virginia. Teflon was, until 2013, produced with perfluorocannabinoic acid, or PFOA, or C8. Studies have found that PFOA exposure is linked with several diseases. Leaked internal company documents revealed that DuPont knew about the dangers of PFOA as far back as 1961 and knew in 1984 that the chemical was present in the local water supply and being emitted in dust from the factory chimneys, yet did not disclose this to the workers or the surrounding public. According to a 2004 study by an industry risk assessor hired by DuPont, the plant dumped and emitted over 1.7 million pounds of PFOA between 1951 and 2003. People who worked in the factory, families living in the local area, or communities living downriver affected by water pollution, all claiming to have illnesses linked to PFOA pollution, filed numerous lawsuits against DuPont. A local family sued DuPont in 1998 over loss of cattle, allegedly due to the pollution from the nearby PFOA sludge-laden landfill. The lawsuit was settled in 2001 for an undisclosed amount. The information about PFOA uncovered in this lawsuit led to a class action in 2001 on behalf of 80,000 people living in districts whereby PFOA had leaked into the water supply. This class action was settled in 2005, with DuPont agreeing to provide up to $235 million for medical monitoring for over 70,000 people living in six water districts around the plant in Parkersburg. By 2014, there was a growing number of individual lawsuits against DuPont for PFOA-related diseases, and several plaintiffs were selected for test cases to demonstrate how the others would fare. In 2017, DuPont agreed to pay these victims $670 million to settle these C8 lawsuits. In this insider exclusive network TV special, DuPont's Poisoning of America, Larry Moody's story, our news team is on location in Pensacola, Florida, to meet with Wes Bowden at Levin Papantonio Rafferty, who successfully sued DuPont on behalf of four of their clients who were harmed by DuPont's dumping of PFOA, otherwise known as C8, used in producing Teflon at DuPont's Washington Works facility, located on the Ohio River near Parkersburg, West Virginia. Little did Larry Moody, a victim of DuPont's pollution, know that during the 1970s, the 1980s, and the 1990s, he was drinking C8 contaminated water. In 2001, after consuming C8 contaminated cancer-causing water from the Belpre Water District, for nearly a decade, he was diagnosed with testicular cancer and nearly died. In this network TV special, Wes Bowden will explain how the EPA did virtually nothing to protect Americans, how the FDA, like the EPA, recklessly let the chemical industry introduce new PFAS chemicals for use in food wrappers and packaging, how the Defense Department failed to deal adequately with the crisis, and how the Pentagon tried to block release of a federal toxic agency's recommendation of a much lower safe level of PFAS than the EPA's health advisory level. On Monday, October 18th, 2021, the Biden administration moved to regulate toxic forever chemicals that pose health risks to millions of Americans, even as they continue to be used in an array of products such as cosmetics, dental floss, food packaging, clothing, and cleaning supplies. This is the Insider Exclusive, live from Pensacola, Florida. My great pleasure to introduce Wes Bowden to the show. Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me.
Tell our audience a little bit about your law firm. What do you guys practice?
Well, we specialize in complex litigation. We've been around since 1955, but we've taken on the biggest corporations from big tobacco, big pharma, a lot of the environmental polluters as well.
Okay. Today we're here on a case that they made a movie of, Dark Waters. And it's on a chemical called C8, Forever Chemical. Tell our audience a little bit about this entire case. What were the facts? What did DuPont and 3M do?
Yeah, so C8 is a part of a class of chemicals that are known as PFOS substances. These are incredibly stable, incredibly persistent chemicals. They stay in the environment for millions of years, and that's actually 3M and DuPont's estimate. So once these chemicals are manufactured, they find their way into things like Scotch Guard, Teflon pans, anything that has any sort of water repelling properties, in all likelihood has some of these chemicals in it. And so back in the 50s, 3M made these chemicals. DuPont started producing Teflon, and really the story starts there in West Virginia back in the late 1960s.
Tell us a little bit about the timeline of internal memos that you discovered in this case that showed that DuPont and 3M were aware that these were deadly chemicals.
Right. So they began studying these chemicals back in the 1960s, and they tested them on lab animals, rats, mice, monkeys. And what they found was that as they were subjecting these animals to these chemicals, the animals were dying. They didn't even live long enough to show adverse effects. As they fed them longer and smaller doses, they realized that there were liver tumors, testicular tumors, kidney tumors. When they fed it to monkeys, which are a great surrogate for you and I, it's the closest thing to humans, the monkeys died. All of the monkeys died. And so what they realized is they had a very potent chemical that they were releasing into the environment, that they had no idea where the chemicals would wind up and what impact it was going to have on people in our environment.
And this happened all over the United States, didn't it?
It did, and to some extent, you know, there are major manufacturing facilities throughout the United States. DuPont's largest one where they use these chemicals was in Parkersburg, West Virginia. But the chemicals themselves, you're absolutely right, have found their way into every household in America and really every household in the world.
Tell us about what the military knew in terms of the danger of these chemicals and what they did or didn't do.
So in the 1960s, the military formed a contract with 3M, and they asked to have firefighting foams, things that would put out burning jet fuels, fires that weren't your normal, you know, wood-burning type of fires. And 3M came up with a novel new fire suppressant. They called that AFFF, aqueous film-forming foams. And the key ingredient, their magic ingredient, was PFOS, one of these C8 substances. And 3M, for decades, lied to the government, both the EPA, the Department of Defense, all of our brave men and women in uniform, about the toxic hazards that they knew internally were associated with this chemical.
Your firm represented, I'm aware of, four individuals who were harmed. And you brought them to, including one of them, Larry Moody, who we're going to have on in a minute. Tell us the legal strategies that you were up against.
Well, the challenges were, they appeared very daunting, almost insurmountable at first, but we dug in, we looked at millions of pages of documents. Mike Papantonio was one of the leaders of the litigation, along with Rob Ballot, who really uncovered the whole story. And he started that back in the late 1990s. And so it took about 15 years to get these cases to trial. And during that time, people like Larry, people like Kenneth Vigneron and others who we tried their cases, they had no idea that they had been exposed to these chemicals through their drinking water. The companies were releasing it into the environment and just getting people's drinking water, and they were unknowingly dosing themselves with this harmful toxin.
In many of these cases, like the forever chemicals or tobacco, and particularly the C8 chemicals, the Environmental Protection Agency was aware of the danger of these chemicals, but did nothing. Why?
So it's a point that we've been uncovering now for many years in our litigation. While the EPA and the FDA and other government agencies were aware that these chemicals were being used, the EPA and FDA do not have the means to test. They don't have the means to see what the scope and fate of these chemicals are in the environment. And so they rely upon industry. And every time they reached out to the DuPonts and the 3Ms of the world, they were lied to.
Yeah, that's like asking the fox whether he ate any chickens today in the hen house, right?
Exactly right, yep.
What is Congress doing about this now?
So Congress now, under multiple administrations, has been dragging their feet to regulate this chemical. There's enough information known now that these substances are hazardous and should be designated as such. Biden's administration, underneath the current EPA director, is moving to designate both PFOA and PFOS, C8 chemicals, as hazardous underneath the Superfund Act. So there is some movement being taken now. Unfortunately, it's come many, many years later than it should have.
Why do you think they're dragging their feet?
I think it's difficult for them to regulate chemicals. The process is very slow. They need industry buy-in as well in order to effectively transition from products that contain this to products that don't contain it. So we have a difficulty in getting people to transition away from these legacy chemicals that have worked.
Okay, let me ask you, you mentioned a phrase, buy-in, industry buy-in. In other words, what you're saying is they need the industries to cooperate so that you don't shut down an entire plant, right? And move to a less dangerous type chemical.
Well, what they realize is all these departments, it takes them years and years to have regulatory enforcement actions. And their strategy, which has harmed people, is to try to get the industry to voluntarily withdraw or change their formulations. They feel that that's a more effective and faster route than holding these companies fully accountable.
Now, we talked about federal agencies. What about state governments? What are they doing?
Many states, most states, are following the federal government's lead on the issues related to PFAS. There are some states that have been much faster, much more proactive, and they have set maximum contamination levels. The EPA in 2006 demanded there be a phase out. but industry had to agree over about a five-year period to phase out production of these chemicals. So since 2015, these chemicals have not been made in our country and have not been imported.
That sounds insane in a way, doesn't it? I mean, it allows the companies to continue to kill people, correct?
Well, it allows them to continue to increase the risk to you and I, to our friends, families, and children.
Your law firm tried 4 cases to date on this same issue. One of them was Carla Bartlett. Can you tell us a little bit about that case?
Ms. Bartlett resided in the Mid-Ohio Valley. She had been drinking water. Her drinking water of her tap, along with Mr. Freeman and Mr. Vigneron, was contaminated. She had no idea it was contaminated with these substances. And for years, in some of these clients' cases, decades, they were dosing themselves unwittingly with a cancer-causing chemical. And this wasn't just about those three individuals. While they got to have their day in court before a jury, and the jury got to see all the secrets that DuPont kept internally and wouldn't share publicly, there were 3,500 other clients that we also represented. They poisoned a community of approximately 80,000 people over several decades.
And one of them was Larry Moody, right?
Yes, Larry.
Tell our audience a little bit about Larry.
So Larry was in the community known as Belpre, just across the river, slightly upstream from DuPont's major C8 using plant. That was Washington Works in Parkersburg, West Virginia. And for many decades, the smokestacks in Parkersburg, West Virginia, at this DuPont plant, were emitting these toxic chemicals, and the wind was blowing them upstream and depositing it into his community's well field. So his water became contaminated, and for about 10 years, he was drinking C8 contaminated water, and unfortunately, he ultimately developed cancer.
Today, we have your client here, Larry, and we're going to bring him on right now. It is my great pleasure to introduce Larry Moody to the show. Thanks for being here, Larry.
Thank you, sir. Glad to be here.
So, Larry, you have gone through hell and back, haven't you?
Yes, sir, I have.
Tell our audience a little bit about what happened to you.
I just started getting some pain and things in my testicle area. And it got pretty excruciating, you know. And it started getting hard and things of this nature, and I knew something wasn't right. And so I went to my doctor, and he had first told me that it's possible to be a calcium deposit. And I had gotten a second opinion on that from another doctor, and he immediately took me in the next morning, and he had removed my right testicle and told me I had testicular cancer. And then at that time, he had told me that I need to go to Dr. Klein in the Cleveland Clinic in Cleveland, Ohio. And they had put a big old zipper, a big cut down in the front of me, and basically, to my understanding, that took my insides out, and they took 34 lymph nodes out and then put me back together. But one of them had cancer in it. And then at that point in time, they told me that if I took a certain kind of chemo, I shouldn't have to go through any radiation, which I didn't. Chemo is called platinal. And they told me I was going to be sick on it. Boy, they wasn't exaggerating a bit. I never vomited so much in my life. Lost a bunch of weight, lost my hair. But the vomiting is what really, really got me. I'd try to eat something. I put my poor old wife to hell and back. I'd say something sounds good, and bless her heart, she'd run to the store and go grab it and bring it home, and I should fix it, and I'd take a bite of it and into the bath. And a lot of times she would literally just cover me up in the bathroom. I mean, I couldn't even, I just vomited so much.
How has this whole experience affected your life and your standard of living?
You know, it's hard for me to even wrap my mind around what DuPont done to the place I called home. You know, I watched the thing a while back. I've seen it several times about over there in Russia, that Chernobyl, and what that disaster done to that area. To me, it's no different what DuPont had done to ours. You know, I growed up deer hunting, rabbit hunting, squirrel hunting, fishing, and everything like that. And it doesn't matter what you kill and eat, it's going to have C8 in it. I mean, to me, they totally ruined our home, you know, and our hometown and everything. And you know, it's one of the highest rated cancerous places anywhere in the United States, you know. But to me, it's just hard. I don't have a problem with someone making a dollar. That's the all-American way. But if people's lives are at stake because of it, you know, or to do what they done to our community, nah. And you know, how can you put a price tag on a human life? And that upsets me more than anything. You know, I work construction. I understand, you know, that everybody needs good jobs and things like that. You know, I'm all for that. I was raised in a union home. My daddy was a pipe fitter and things of this nature. But what DuPont done, I don't know. It's just kind of hard to put into words. To this day, I can't wrap my mind around it. To be quite honest with you, I mean, being upset about it and all that, I guarantee you, I'll take to my grave with me. You know, I don't know. I mean, you know, I don't. I'm just flabbergasted about it, really.
You're on national TV right now. Obviously, a inanimate corporation didn't make the decision to poison America. Individuals did at the corporation. So what message do you want to send to DuPont's corporate officers right now?
I wouldn't have done it to their family. I wouldn't have done it to their hometown. I would have took a bullet in the head first. And that's the best way I know to explain it. I wouldn't have done it to them. To make a dollar? Nah. A person's life is worth more than a dollar bill. And I guess if I had my chance to say it to them, that's just about how I'd put it. I wouldn't have done it to them. Okay. I wouldn't have made them go through the hell they put me and my family through and everybody that still lives there. It'll never go away. It's a wasteland. No, I wouldn't have done it to them, not to make a buck. You know, I guess that's just about what I'd say to them. You know, I wouldn't have done it to them. You know, they turn around and they get rich and stuff off us at our lives, at our expenses of death. No, that's not right. You know, I wouldn't have done it to them. I just wouldn't have. I wouldn't have done it to anybody, but I wouldn't have done it to them and their families.
Well, I want to thank you for coming on the show. I wanted to thank you for sending that message because they should be held responsible.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
What are PFAS and why are they called forever chemicals?
So PFAS chemicals are basically carbon compounds that have fluorine attached to them. And what's really unique about these compounds is that when you have fluorine attached, they become almost indestructible. So they're known as forever chemicals because there is no natural process. There's no bacteria. There's nothing in our environment that will break these compounds down once they're released.
What does these letters stand for?
So PFOS stands for perfluoroalkyl substances.
Okay, and PFOA?
The way is perfluorooctanoic acid.
And they're related?
They are. PFOA and PFOS are two specific types of compounds in that broader class that have been studied the most. We know the most about those two.
When in your discovery process, you discovered that DuPont was aware as early as, what, 1961, that these were dangerous chemicals. oftentimes you see in cases where you have whistleblowers come forward, they're retaliated against, they're fired, whatever. Was there ever anybody that came forward and tried to bring this to the attention of any governmental agency or law firm?
No, in fact, we saw just the opposite, where there was information being shared with people such as the West Virginia Environmental Protection Agency. DuPont went out of its way to make sure that those people were retained as experts and did not speak poorly about the company. So we saw just the opposite.
So they get paid extra money.
That's right.
Wow. And no legal action can be taken against them?
Well, there wasn't taken in time. We discovered this during the course of our litigation.
What are the health risks of PFAS?
So PFAS right now, there's a lot of funding, a lot of academics that are now looking at it, and we aren't aware of the full scope of problems. We know for a fact that it causes testicular and kidney cancer. We know for a fact that it causes problems with kids and having an adequate response to vaccines. We know for a fact that it causes problems in pregnancy for women. But the whole scope of problems is not known. And on a routine basis, almost every month, it feels like new publications are coming out showing additional health effects.
Yeah, list a common list of products that have these chemicals in them and what we should do to be aware of that and stop using them.
Right. So the most damaging products, in my view, have been the Scotchgard, Scotch Band. They use a substance that's known as PFBS. We believe it to be toxic. We also know that there are these substances, at least up until 2015, in all of our hamburger wrappers, popcorn containers.
Still today?
Still today, there are PFAS substances found in paper products that are used for food packaging.
So that passes to the through to the food, right?
Absolutely.
And we're eating it.
Mm-hmm.
As a person who's very much involved with the discovery of, in this case, what are you totally avoiding? You?
The biggest source of exposure for us is through our drinking water. So we're extra cautious about our sources of drinking water and making sure that they're adequately filtered.
How long can these chemicals stay in the body?
Scientific consensus is that if you're exposed to a molecule of C8, or if you drink a glass of water contaminated with C8, it will stay in your body for almost 25 years before it's eliminated.
And causing damage?
Potentially causing damage.
Is there any treatment to remove these chemicals from your body?
There's no treatment.
Is there any way to remove the chemicals from the water supplies?
There are from the water supplies. And the water supplies can be treated with a number of technologies, including ion exchange, carbon filtration. The difficulty is that it is incredibly expensive to treat a community's water supply. So most of our towns simply don't have the funds or the resources to make the water safe.
But don't they have to really do this, right, eventually?
That's what we're hoping the EPA will take action on, is to set an enforceable federal standard that all water providers throughout our country have to adhere to.
Well, your case is going to bring this to their attention. You know, this was a huge case. I think DuPont paid out between 2005 and when was the 2015, the settlement, $700 and some odd million, almost $1 billion so far, right? Are there other cases in the pipeline that your law firm is handling?
Absolutely. We represent many, many states, cities, and territories throughout our country, and have been bringing lawsuits against 3M and DuPont for contaminating the environment, and in particular, the water tables.
Well, let me ask you this. The discovery's already done. We know what they did, correct?
We know a lot of it.
Why isn't DuPont settling all these other cases, considering the fact that the same evidence is going to come out?
That's a great question. It's one that keeps me up at night, too. What are we missing? What is it going to take to force them to settle? And I think, unfortunately, it's going to require government intervention, and it's going to require getting these cases in front of a jury.
And what they're hoping for is a change in the government, the politics, right? So that environmental regulations are lessened and they're not held responsible.
They are hoping that environmental regulations will never come into being, that everything they want is to delay. They want to delay scientific development, progress from our medical doctors, and they want to delay regulatory action.
Anybody in the country can contact your firm to have your firm represent them in this area, correct?
Absolutely.
Okay. I want to thank you for being on the show and keep up the good work.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. You can get more information about our guests and the issues at insiderexclusive.com.